Good morning. Welcome to St. John the Baptist Catholic Church in New Freedom, Pennsylvania. Let us say together the prayer to St. John the Baptist. St. John, you were privileged to baptize our Savior in the Jordan, where the Father declared him as his beloved Son and sent the Holy Spirit to anoint him as the Christ for our salvation. You prepared the way of the Lord by calling us to repent of our sins through baptism in Jesus. Intercede for our parish that God's mercy will heal us in body, mind, and soul, and that God's grace will perfect us in faith, hope, and love. As we celebrate this Mass today, may your voice once again draw us to the Word of God, who teaches us in spirit and in truth. May your voice once again lead us to the Lamb of God, who feeds us with the bread from heaven. Throughout our lives, may we follow your example of courage in testifying to the light, so that one day we may be welcomed with joy to the banquet feast of eternal life. Amen. St. John the Baptist, please take a moment to silence all cell phones and other electronic devices. Today we celebrate the first Sunday of Lent. The intention of this Mass is for the people of the parish, and our priest will be Father Cavender. The entrance hymn is "Again We Keep This Solemn Fast," and can be found in your worship aid.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
My brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries.
Lord Jesus, you came to reconcile us to one another. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you heal the wounds of sin and division. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you intercede for us with the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. Grant, Almighty God, through the yearly observances of Holy Lent, that we may grow in understanding of the riches hidden in Christ, and by worthy conduct pursue their effects. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Genesis. God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "See, I am establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you, and with every living creature that was with you, all the birds and the various tame and wild animals that were with you and came out of the ark. I will establish my covenant with you, that never again shall all bodily creatures be destroyed by the waters of a flood. There shall not be another flood to devastate the earth." God added, "This is the sign that I am giving for all ages to come, of the covenant between me and you, and every living creature with you. I set my bow in the clouds to serve as a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth and the bow appears in the clouds, I will recall the covenant I have made between me and you and all living beings, so that the water shall never again become a flood to destroy all mortal beings." The word of the Lord.
Your ways, O Lord, are love and truth.
A reading from the first letter of St. Peter. Beloved, Christ suffered for sins once, the righteous for the sake of the unrighteous, that he might lead you to God. Put to death in the flesh, he was brought to life in the spirit. In it, he also went to preach to the spirits in prison, who had once been disobedient, while God patiently waited in the days of Noah, during the building of the ark, in which a few persons, eight in all, were saved through water. This prefigured baptism, which saves you now. It is not a removal of dirt from the body, but an appeal to God for a clear conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who was gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers subject to him. The word of the Lord.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. The Spirit drove Jesus out into the desert, and he remained in the desert for 40 days, tempted by Satan. He was among wild beasts, and the angels ministered to him. After John had been arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the gospel of God. This is the time of fulfillment. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. The gospel of the Lord.
I believe 2 weeks ago, I gave a homily about the Gospel of Mark and how he is, one of the main focuses of the Gospel of Mark is that Jesus Christ has come as the Lion of Judah, and he is as the Lion of Judah, the King of Judah, coming to claim his kingdom for God, right? To establish the kingdom of heaven on earth, which means that he is on a warpath with the kingdom of Satan. Now, I don't know how much more clearly that we can see that than in today's gospel, right, where Christ literally does battle with Satan in the desert, and then he calls us to repent, to join his war effort against Satan and his forces. Okay, so let's dive into this passage a little bit and kind of see what's kind of going on. Mark is like a concentrated gospel, so there's so much that's said in such a small amount of space. It's hard not to get excited about some of these passages. Well, all of them, because it's, you know, divine scripture and stuff like that. But anyway, so number one, it says Jesus was driven out into the desert by the Spirit. So he knew he was going to be like tempted out there, right? So but this is like the Holy Spirit is pushing him. There's like this sense of like Christ like almost was forcibly shoved out into the desert by the Holy Spirit. And so we see that like the divine will of God, as you know, kind of personified by the Holy Spirit. That's a great theological way to say that, but anyway, is pushing Christ out into the desert, into this warpath, right? It is now like his public ministry has started after his baptism, and now it is time to start attacking Satan. And to do that first, he does that in the desert. And so that's the next part, the desert. The desert is often, it's a desolate place. So it's oftentimes seen as a place separated from God, as in a sense, a realm of the demonic. Does that mean if you're going to go through the desert, like all of a sudden demons are going to attack you? Not exactly. But it's just kind of symbolically seen as this, in a sense, demonic place. And so it is desolate. It's hot. It's nasty. Have you ever stayed for a long time in the desert? Like, you walk around a lot, and like your legs and your back are kind of tired, so you want to sit down on something, but everything that there is to sit down on is either hot or sharp. Right? It's not exactly that fun and comfortable of a place to be. So he's like preparing himself by doing this spiritual workout of just becoming uncomfortable. And on top of that, he fasts for 40 days. Now, I don't know if this was like a complete absence of food for 40 days or if this was kind of like the very, very small meals, minimal to keep you alive. I'm not sure. But I think it's safe to say that if any of us were out there for 40 days fasting, we would not just be hungry, we would be full-blown hangry. Like, we would be, like, ready to tear somebody's head off with the smallest thing that went wrong, right? And so it's in this point where Christ is physically drained. He's been in this, like, spiritual war zone for 40 days. And then in walks the Prince of Darkness himself. He didn't send like the little minion demon that of hell. Like the Prince of Hell himself, Satan, walks out to try to tempt the Son of God. And Christ shows his complete power over Satan and his temptations. He didn't fall for any of his tricks. If you'd like to see any of those tricks, read either like Matthew or Luke, and the whole story will be there. Right, Mark just shortens it down to Jesus won. Surprise, right? So, right? Christ shows his complete power over sin and temptation. Now, there's kind of a caveat to that. We learned theologically that in seminary that it was not actually possible for Jesus Christ to sin. So, does that mean this whole like temptation thing was just kind of like, he's like, oh look, he's trying to tempt me, ha 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 ha. He can't do that. Is that what Jesus Christ is doing here in this gospel? That he can't actually sin? No, that's not exactly like, it's not like when God was thinking like, I'd like to become incarnate to save these people, but you know, just to make sure we don't have a repeat of the Adam and Eve thing, I'm gonna put a sin blocker in this model, right? That's not what happened. See, the reason that Jesus can't sin is because of his divine knowledge. Right? Jesus Christ has is fully God, fully man, and so he has a divine will and a human will. And so he has this divine knowledge. So in his divinity, he knows how good God is because he knows himself. He knows how truly good it is to be in a relationship with God. So to sin and to damage that relationship and even break that relationship, he knows what it would cost and how horrible it would be to be separated from that relationship with God. The decision is so simple for Jesus Christ. And it would be like if somebody came up to you and offered and said, you know, you've won a prize, for real, this isn't one of those phone scams, on this side, you win $1 million tax-free, no strings attached. Or on this side, you can die by firing squad. Your choice. Like, is anybody here really going to choose to die by firing squad? No. That's such a ridiculous option. And honestly, for Jesus Christ, that is how simple the choice is between good and evil. Temptation is like saying, do you want to die by firing squad? Really? Right? It doesn't work like that, right? Like it does work like that. Jesus Christ simply chooses the obvious good thing to do. And it doesn't matter whatever physical torments might come with that, whether it be the cross or be fasting for 40 days, it is easy for him to choose the right thing. And in that moment, temptation and Satan are defeated. So he goes out after showing his power over Satan and his temptations, and he goes and he proclaims, repent and believe in the gospel. Now, in that same homily before, I talked about how the euangelion, the good news, the gospel, was how kings would, like when they would conquer, they would go out and they would announce to the entire town, right? There's good news. I am now your king, which in the human realm can either be, you know, good or not so good. But for Jesus Christ, it is very, very good that he is now our king. But what's this word repent? What does that mean? The Greek word is metanoia. It literally means to have a change of mind, to have a changing of how you think and perceive the world. So he is calling us to change our mind and to believe the good news that he has conquered, which means that for Jesus Christ, this call to repent means that we are either going to change our mind and follow the kingdom of God, the kingdom of the Lion of Judah, or we are not going to change our mind, and we are going to stay in the kingdom of Satan and his rebellion against God. Those are our two choices. We're either going to repent and join the fight against Satan and his temptation, or we're going to stay right where we are and continue to fight against God constantly in everything that we do. So, we need to have a metanoia, a change. Choosing to choose Jesus Christ is to choose to change our mind and to do battle with Satan. All right. So that means we have one really important question left to ask, and that is, how do we actually do battle with Satan? When we change our minds, when we have this conversion, and we decide to follow Jesus Christ and be a part of the kingdom of heaven and join against battling Satan, how do we actually do battle with Satan? Like last time I checked, you didn't go out into the desert for 40 days and all of a sudden this like weird scary dude showed up and was like, hey, you wanna like rule the world? Follow me, right? Like that's not exactly what we're talking about here. There's two things that we can do very simply to battle the power of Satan. Number one is Satan most often works through temptation. So in order to be like Christ, we need to battle that temptation as well. And how Christ did it, right, was to have this very clear knowledge of what is good and what is evil, and to understand how good the good thing is and how bad the sin is. So one thing that we can do is get an examination of conscience. Find one that hurts. Right, the one that kind of digs in a little bit and kind of makes you feel uncomfortable, that's the one that we should go with. And then pick the one that hurts the most, the sin that cuts in the deepest, because that's probably the one that we're going to have to deal with. And then understand how that truly separates us from God and how good it is to be in that relationship with God, so that we can have a better understanding that this is the $1 million versus the firing squad, okay? And that will be able to, like when temptation comes, we can simply remind ourselves, no, that's not going to be nearly as good as what I have in Jesus Christ. It's not going to be as good as what I have in my relationship with the Father, right? And it's going to separate me from the power of the Holy Spirit. It's not worth it. So once we have that though, right, we have this mental side of it. We understand, but we're also weak creatures, right? Like, is anybody surprised by that? Like, we try to do stuff all the time and we just absolutely tank and fail. right? So how do we do this? St. Ignatius actually offers us a really good method for battling sin in our life. So after we've identified that sin that like cuts into us, the one that we need to do battle with, that point that Satan has decided to attack us on, we need to pick that sin. And what St. Ignatius does, he was a soldier. And so as a soldier, he realized that you don't battle an army. That's kind of silly. There's not this ambiguous idea of army out there that we battle. Just like there's not an ambiguous idea of sin that we battle. I can't battle sin in my life. An army is individual soldiers battling individual soldiers. So in our spiritual life, we have our, right, we need to do battle, not just with sin, but individual sins. And I need to attack that sin until I have mastery over it. Right? You can't somehow beat an army without interacting with individual soldiers. We need to attack on an individual soldier level. So he would identify a sin, and he would wake up in the morning and he would say, Lord, today I am doing battle with this sin. Give me the eyes that I might be able to see it in my life, and then give me the strength to do battle with it that I might conquer it. And he would look throughout the day. Okay, where is this sin? Where is this sin? Where is this sin? It would be constantly on his mind. And he would see it, and it wouldn't surprise him because he was expecting it. And then he would choose to not do it. Now, sometimes he wouldn't choose to not do it. You know, like, let's say I'm working with, like, hypothetically, with anger, right? Maybe somebody, does something really annoying in the morning, maybe at work, and I say, no, you know what? I'm going to forgive this person. But then I had to run out to get something, and somebody cut me off in traffic. And if I had the power of God, I would have sent down plagues. I would have sent down a lightning bolt. I would have like had the earth swallow their car up, and that would have been the end of that person. And then afterwards, you realize like, oh, maybe that anger thing kind of happened, right? I didn't think about that. So I check in at lunchtime and I say, okay, well, how did things go at lunchtime? Well, I did really good that one time, but the other time I completely failed. All right, I'm going to do better in the afternoon. I'm going to be more aware of it. So we go to the afternoon and we do better and we do better and we do better. But then I was really hungry and I was coming home for dinner, right? And my spouse was there and they didn't do this project that I asked them to do. And guess what? They got both barrels, right? They just asked you to do one thing. Why didn't you do this? And so we get, so then as we're going to bed, we do an examination of conscience. How did I do in the morning? And how did that compare to the evening? Well, I did good a couple more times. But then I completely failed because I was really hungry. Okay, I'll have to note when I'm coming home, I'm hungry. I might be a little short-tempered. I'll just be a little bit more aware of that, okay? And so over the weeks, he would do battle with his sin over and over and over and over again until he had mastery over it. And then he would move to the next soldier. He would pick the next sin that would dig in and that would hurt. And he did this over and over and over again until he was a man of immense virtue. My brothers and sisters, we need to have this metanoia, this life of repentance. And this is our 40 days in the desert to be able to do battle with Satan. We need to make that firm resolve to join the kingdom of heaven, to join the kingdom of Jesus Christ, which means that we have to do battle with our sins. Join Jesus Christ. Allow him to teach us how truly good it is to be in his kingdom and how truly bad it is to fall into sin and to defect from his kingdom. And then when we see those places where Satan is trying to tempt us, do battle with him. Choose a standing ground in your life with sin and do battle with that sin until you have mastery over it. And that's how we strive for great virtue and spread that kingdom of heaven in our own soul. So, this is our 40 days of Lent. Let's do battle with Satan and let's do battle with our own sins.
I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate in the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Our Savior calls us to repent and believe in the good news. Let us pray that he will keep the covenant of our baptism in this season of grace.
Our response to the petitions is, Lord, have mercy. That the church may continue to preach faith and repentance, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That the leaders of nations may embrace God's covenant of peace and justice, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That people who are attached to material things will learn that no one lives by bread alone, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That all who are sick, especially Jim Orland, Bill Otto, and Marie Coyle, and all those listed in this Book of the Sick, find healing and hope, comfort and solace during this season of grace, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That Patty Dameron O'Brien and all our beloved departed may live forever in the transfigured glory of Christ, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy. We come before you, Father, confident that you hear us through the new and eternal covenant of your beloved Son, who lives forever and ever. Amen.
To all the earth.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Give us the right dispositions, O Lord, we pray, to make these offerings, for with them we celebrate the beginning of this venerable and sacred time. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. By abstaining 40 long days from earthly food, he consecrated through his fast the pattern of Lenten observance, and by overturning all the snares of the ancient serpent, taught us to cast out the leaven of malice, so that celebrating worthily the Paschal mystery, we might pass over at last to the eternal Paschal feast. And so, with the company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise, as without end we acclaim.
Sanctus, Sanctus, Sanctus Dominus Deus.
Indeed, holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Save us, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven. And as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Patrick, Saint John the Baptist, Saint Pio, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Ronald, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may always be free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi, miserere nobis. Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi, miserere nobis. Agnus Dei,
behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
in the shelter of the Most High and abides in the shade of the Almighty. Says to the Lord, my refuge, my stronghold, my God, in whom I trust.
The Lord will overshadow you, and you will find refuge under his wings.
It is he who will free you from the snare of the fowler who seeks to destroy you. For you he has commanded his angels to keep you in all your ways.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Renewed now with heavenly bread by which faith is nourished and hope increased and charity strengthened, we pray, O Lord, that we may learn to hunger for Christ, the true and living bread, and strive to live by every word which proceeds from your mouth, through Christ our Lord. Amen. A few quick announcements this week. The Lenten prayer books are available at the tables at the back of the church, so if you're still looking for a little devotion or something to do for Lent this year, that's a great option ready to go for you right here on your way out. So there are extra masses added to, just for extra prayer stuff if you'd like to do during this Lent. We have an extra mass at 6 a.m. on Friday in the historic church. So if you're up at 6 o'clock in the morning on a Friday and want to get to Mass, there will be a Mass. And then on Fridays at 7 p.m. here in the main church, we will have stations. So if you're still awake by 7 p.m., we will have stations here. We'd love to have you join us to walk the Stations of the Cross with us. So in addition to our normal penance schedule, which is 8 a.m. on Saturday until 8:45 before the 9 a.m. Mass. We also have 3:30 to 4:30 p.m. Before the 5 p.m. Mass for confessions. We also have confessions Monday after the 9 a.m. Mass. And then we are adding 6 p.m. to 7 p.m. on Thursdays. So there is an abundance of time to get to confession. Please take an opportunity. It is, if you're talking about doing battle with Satan and sin in your life, there is no better place to go than confession. So if you haven't been in a while, don't worry. It turns out priests have been through confession a couple times. So just say, Father, I don't know what to do. And we'll say, don't worry, I'll help you. And that's about the extent of how complicated that is. Okay, so come to confession and get all of that sin off of your soul. So 6 a.m. Friday morning Mass, 7 p.m. stations, and we have an added Thursday at 6 p.m. Time for confession right here in the main church. Okay, next weekend we will conduct a very short in-pew campaign for the diocesan annual campaign, just for those who have not received their envelope in the mail. Yesterday it was wonderful. Give out congratulations to our second grade class who received their first penance yesterday. So they were so holy, they basically floated out of the church. It was amazing. So if you see any of our second graders, make sure to give them a little congratulations on doing their first penance. And as also on the way back out after Mass, we are having a collection for the coins for babies. So if you have change, cash, anything like that that you'd like to give, it is all going to the crisis pregnancy centers in York that we support that are 100% run off of donations. So yes, it's a good and worthy cause to promote life this Lent. All right. The Lord be with you.
Bow your head for the blessing.
May bountiful blessing, O Lord, we pray, come down upon your people, that they may grow in tribulation, that hope may grow in tribulation, virtue be strengthened in temptation, and eternal redemption be assured through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Go forth, the Mass is ended.
Thanks be to God.
Returning us.
Okay.